without hope, without love, till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes, to fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory, to a cradle.
Thank you. place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down at the cross. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all
Good morning, church. Welcome to First Baptist. We're glad to have you here. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we're so thankful we can be here today to celebrate Palm Sunday, the week that Jesus comes to town in Jerusalem and be crucified on the cross for our sins. Thank you for loving us so much. for sending your one and only Son to die on the cross to save us from our sins. Be with Brother Doug. Be with Derrick today as they lead us. And may you be honored and glorified in all that we do today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's all stand. We're going to sing this wonderful hymn. I stand amazed in his presence. We're going to sing four verses this morning. Y'all feeling okay? Amen. Good to see you in the house of the Lord. Let's sing together.
I stand.
Aren't you glad of his love? We have another hymn we want to do for you all. Praise to the Lord Almighty. That's what we're here to do. You know, that's really our job. Everything that we have, everything that we are, God does for us. This is one thing that I'll never, ever be guilty. I'm not going to let a rock cry out for me. Anybody else got a witness with that? I'm going to be a praiser. I decided I'm old enough to learn how to do it, know how to do it. And I'm gonna do it. So praise the Lord with me this morning.
My soul praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation.
with us. Feel free to sing it with us.
Praise to the Lord, who are all things so wondrously great. Shelters the under his wings, so gently sustain him. Hast thou ever seen all of thy longings templated? Granted in what he ordained.
What he ordained. Love you so much. You're so good to us. When you're faithful in our unfaithfulness, you allow us to come to you every morning with new mercies. We're so thankful for that. We just ask that you would bless your people today. We ask that you would allow your grace and mercy to reign over us, protect us. We're so grateful to be alive. We pray for those who are going through tough times. But we're so grateful for the fact that even in tough times, around us can seemingly consume us. They don't have to be inside of us because you are greater than anything that's in the world. Bless our pastor as he blesses us this morning. God, we're thankful for this opportunity to come into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. We're thankful to you and we bless your holy name. In your matchless name we pray. Amen.
that paid my way. Death is price. When it flowed down from the cross, my sins were gone. My sins forgot. There is a grave try to hide this precious blood. Gave me life. In 3 days he breathed again and rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell you he's alive. Tell you that he drives every tear.
to hide this precious blood that gave me life.
But in 3 days.
Matthew 21, verse 1 through 15. And when they had approached Jerusalem and had come to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied there and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. And if anyone says something to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and immediately he will send them." Now this took place that what was spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, gentle and mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." And the disciples went and did just as Jesus had directed them, and brought the donkey and the colt, and laid them on their garments on which he sat. And most of the multitude spread their garments in the road, and others were cutting branches from the trees and spreading them in the road. And the multitudes going before him and those followed after were crying out, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred, saying, "Who is this?" And the multitudes were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." And Jesus entered the temple and cast out all those who were buying and selling in the temple, and overturned the tables and the money changers and the seats of those who were selling doves. And he said to them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you are making it a robber's den." And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he had done, and the children who were crying out in the temple and saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they became indignant.
Thank you.
shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I'll never, never, never know just why he came to love me so.
Amen. What a joy it is to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I pray that you've already been blessed. A few weeks ago, we turned our clocks forward so that we could begin daylight savings time. This morning, I want to encourage you to turn your clocks back. Not just 1 hour, but about 2,000 years. As we do so, we are suddenly transformed back to the first century A.D. It's difficult to be absolutely certain about the exact year, but it's somewhere between the year A.D. 29 and A.D. 33. The place in which we find ourselves is the city of Jerusalem. The occasion is Passover. the annual feast held to commemorate the deliverance of the Israelites from slavery in Egypt. As it turns out, we've arrived at the beginning of what will prove to be the most important week in human history. This week will come to be known as Passion Week or Holy Week. This designation refers to the final week of our Lord's earthly life and ministry. The significance of this week is illustrated by the amount of attention that it's given in the four accounts of the gospel. For example, Matthew, the longest gospel, devotes 33% of his contents to events that happened during Holy Week. Mark gives 40% of his book to Passion Week. More than 20% of the contents of Luke deal with events that took place during the last week of our Lord's life, while nearly half of the gospel according to John deals with this topic. The emphasis placed on this week lends credibility to my claim that this was the most significant week in the history of humanity. From our vantage point, we have the privilege of witnessing a few of the initial events that occurred as this week began. We've turned our clocks back to the very first Palm Sunday. Earlier on this day, Jesus sent two of his disciples into a small village to borrow a donkey. In contrast to walking, which was his normal mode of transportation, Jesus planned to ride this donkey into the city of Jerusalem to celebrate Passover with his disciples. Due to the fact that the city is filled with people, it was impossible for Jesus to find a place to stay in Jerusalem last night. All the inns were full. Little tents had been erected on every vacant spot. We find ourselves speculating that perhaps Jesus spent last night in Bethany at the home of his friends Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. As we gaze out over the horizon, we see a group of people approaching. A closer look reveals that it is Jesus riding on the back of a donkey. His disciples are walking along beside of him. Word that Jesus is coming has spread like wildfire. In addition to the fame Jesus has received from performing miracles, countless people in the crowd are hoping that he will lead a revolt against the Roman government that currently controls Jerusalem. Their perception that Jesus would achieve this purpose prompts people to extend not just a warm welcome, but a reception fit for a king. From a distance, we watch as several men take their cloaks off and use them to pave a path through which Jesus could pass. Others cut down palm branches and do the same. And then as Jesus comes close to the city, a cry goes up from the crowd. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna to the Son of David! Instead of responding to the crowd with a wave or even a smile, Jesus appears to have a solemn look on his face. We tag along and try to blend in with the crowd as Jesus makes his way in the direction of the temple. When he arrives at the sacred site, Jesus dismounts from the back of the donkey and enters the temple. No one tries to interrupt him because we sense that he wants some solitude, just to spend some quiet time in prayer with his Heavenly Father. Because of our Gentile background, we're only permitted to enter the outer courts of the temple. But even from this vantage point, we can see that the atmosphere within the temple is not conducive to prayer. Instead of being a place where a person can experience intimate communion with God, the temple is a place of indescribable chaos. And although a huge crowd of people is assembled, we get the impression that most have come for the wrong reasons. Some are there simply because they're required to be there by Jewish law. Therefore, they've come out of a sense of duty or obligation. Others, we can tell, are there because they want to make some money off this holy holiday. I'm referring specifically to the money changers and the animal traders. Based on the way some people are just standing around and talking, it seems that they've just come to socialize with their friends. The level of noise from all this commotion makes it impossible for a person to pray. Our eyes are fixed on Jesus as he beholds this carnival-like scene. We watch as the muscles in our Lord's arms, neck, and face begin to contract. It is obvious that our Lord's anger is becoming aroused. And then we are somewhat startled to see Jesus reach down, pick up some rope and fashion a whip. Everyone is shocked as Jesus proceeds to drive out those who traded animals and those who exchanged money. You can just look at our Lord's eyes to see he's not someone you want to challenge or confront. In a matter of moments, all those who created the chaos rushed from the temple. As Jesus cries out, "It is written, my house should be called a house of prayer, but you have turned it into a den of thieves." And then silence settles over the temple. Once again, it is possible for people to pray. While it is quiet within the temple, the city streets are buzzing with talk about what Jesus has done. Although the money changers and those who sold the animals left feeling defeated, now they've reconvened and decided that they want to seek revenge on Jesus. Plots and protests are taking place all across the city. Over the next couple of days, we are saddened to see how quickly the tide of public opinion has turned against Jesus. The warm welcome he received on Sunday is quickly becoming a dim memory. The echoes of the cries, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," have faded away. We even hear rumors that one of our Lord's disciples is plotting to have him arrested. We want to let Jesus know what's happening, but it is obvious that he's already aware of these circumstances. On Thursday evening, Jesus meets with his disciples to observe the last Passover meal they will share together. And during the course of this meal, Jesus introduces a new theme to this memorial meal. He tells his followers to no longer focus on the lambs that were slain in conjunction with the Exodus from Egypt long ago. Instead, he instructs them to focus on the Lamb of God, whose blood is about to be spilt in order to set them free from the power and penalty of sin. And after instituting the Lord's Supper, Jesus leads his disciples into the Garden of Gethsemane. While few of us would consider ourselves to be prayer warriors, we're disappointed to see that our Lord's disciples can't stay awake with him during this crucial moment of his life. As the night wears on, Jesus continues to pray while the disciples sleep under the cover of darkness. But then the darkness is penetrated by light. The light is coming from lanterns carried by a group of Roman soldiers. We don't have to ask why they're there. We know that they've come to arrest the Savior. It's hard for us to witness what happens next. Following our Lord's arrest, all of his disciples forsake him and flee. In all honesty, we would prefer to follow them rather than him, because we don't want to watch the shame and suffering that our Savior is about to endure. And for the next several hours, Jesus is put through a series of illegal trials. One of the persons before whom Jesus appears is a man named Pilate. To his credit, Pilate recognized that this was one of the most critical moments of his political career. On the one hand, he wanted to just let Jesus go, but on the other hand, he did not want to disappoint his constituents who were crying out for Jesus to be executed. The internal wrestling match he was experiencing is articulated by the question Pilate raised. Listen to it. "What shall I do with this man named Jesus?" It's obvious that Pilate is sympathetic toward the Savior. He even finds a legal loophole that would allow him to let Jesus go. But the crowd will not consider this possibility. As they elect for a convicted criminal to be released instead of Jesus, in an effort to absolve himself from any personal guilt over what's about to happen, Pilate washes his hands while declaring, "I am innocent of this man's blood." Well, our visit to the holy city got off to a great start as we heard the crowd extend warm words of welcome. "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." But the words we will always remember are the cruel cries of, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" And that's exactly what they do. They crucify him. This public execution of Jesus, it's one of the saddest sights we've ever seen. This has been an emotionally draining week for everyone within the vicinity of Jerusalem. To be honest, what we've seen has not been pleasant. But our discomfort pales in comparison with what Jesus has been through. We have watched him praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Father, if you're willing, let this cup pass from me." And we've heard him come to the conclusion, "Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." We have watched in wonder Jesus, who taught his followers to love their enemies and pray for those who despitefully use them and persecute them, practice what he preached as he prayed from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Jesus would speak six more times from the cross before his eyes closed in death. His last words were, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." After attending the graveside service and seeing the tomb sealed with a huge stone, it's time for us to reset our watches as we make the transition back to Natchez. But before the benediction is pronounced and we get in our vehicles and go enjoy lunch with family and friends, let's take just a moment to process what we have seen. And as we do so, there are two things I want to point out. The first is our participatory role. Although the things we have witnessed in reference to our Lord's last week were not pleasant, there is another factor that makes these events even more difficult to digest. And that is, we are not mere spectators when it comes to what we have seen. Instead of watching from a distance, we were there. Each of us has played a participatory role in the events which culminated in the crucifixion of Jesus. I want you to understand this morning that the money changers, the animal traders, Pilate, the religious leaders, and the Roman soldiers were not the only ones who played important roles in this dynamic drama. You and I played participatory roles. If we were just spectators, we could have walked away when the events we witnessed became unpleasant. If this were a television show, we could have changed the channel when decided that we'd watch something a little less gruesome. If this were a play, we could have slipped out during the intermission But these options are not available to us because we're still on stage with Jesus. How did we get there? We got there because every one of us made a conscious choice to sin. And our sin qualified us to play participatory roles in the crucifixion of Jesus. Some of us here this morning would like to follow the example of Pilate by washing our hands and saying, I'm innocent of this man's blood. But none of us can say, not guilty, because we are guilty. The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. On the one hand, we're 2,000 years removed from the cross. But on the other hand, we were there. As the gospel hymn declares, when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. Dear friend, when he was on the cross, you were on his mind. It was for you that Jesus suffered, bled, and died. Your name appears on the credit when we look at this drama. We were there. This wasn't just some little mental exercise. We can't blame the Roman soldiers or Pilate or even the religious leaders. We instead are confronted with the reality that we have sinned. And a loving God is also a just God. And because he's a loving and just God, God so loved you that he gave his only begotten Son. If you believe in him, you would not perish but have everlasting life. And the only thing that can wash away your sin and my sin is the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood. So I want you today to come to grips with the fact that you were there, that you played a role in the crucifixion of Christ. But note not only our participatory role, but also our personal response. As was true of Pilate, each of us must contemplate one of the most important inquiries ever raised. What shall I do with this man named Jesus? What will you do with this man named Jesus? Not only do we play important roles in the crucifixion of Christ, now we've been assigned the responsibility of writing the conclusion of how this story ends in reference to our own lives. And you don't have to be a published author to write the conclusion. There are only a couple of ways this story can end. One, and the best ending is, you can give your life to the one who gave his life for you. That's the one that ends, and they all lived happily ever after. Or you can say, thanks, but no thanks. All this sounds nice, but It's not for me. Passion Week was the most important week in human history. But today can become the most important day in your life. If you will simply say, I have sinned. And I could not ever save myself. I cannot rely upon any of my earthly achievements. I cannot rely on my intelligence, my ability to debate. My good works are insufficient. So I cry out today as I stand before the cross and say, that's my Savior. I want a happy ending for my life. And I want a life that will never end. I want to spend eternity in heaven with one who shed his life's blood for me. This morning, as the pastor of this church, I was given the role of preaching the Word of God. This morning, as a member of this congregation, you have been assigned the role of determining how you're going to respond to that Word. It's a personal response. Choose wisely. Nothing is more important than making the right response to the question, what will I do with this man named Jesus? Would you bow right where you are right now? And I want you to think carefully and prayerfully about the response God wants you to make today. He's done everything he can do to make it possible for you to be saved. And he loves you just like you are. In spite of your faults and your failures, God loves you. I pray today will be the most important day of your life, that this will be the day you finally let go and give your heart to Jesus Christ. Ask the Lord to speak to you, then you make the right response today.
Hadn't it been a blessing to be able to worship the Lord today? So awesome to see y'all. Let's all stand. We're going to sing just a chorus of How Marvelous. Let's sing together.
How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How Savior's love for me.
God bless you. We'll see you at 5 o'clock.